We're live.
Yes.
And welcome back to the Michigan Insider on Sports Talk 1050 WTK, the ticket online at WTK.com. It is a little bit after 9 o'clock on a Thursday, which means it is time for the return of the MGoBlog Roundtable. Sam will be with us momentarily as he converts from one equipment that he uses for radio to a different thing that we use for radio and ticket TV. So we're on Facebook, we're on Twitter, we are on YouTube, and we are joined by the guys. We're joined by Brian Cook, Craig Ross, Seth Fisher. Happy New Year, guys. How are you?
Happy New Year. You know, since we were on last, which has been a few weeks now, I've had this sadness about Don Brown, because on a personal level, he's somebody I really liked, and yet things weren't working out in the football program too well. But he was a person who was so, I don't know, he was so alive, and he was so interesting. And so I was trying to come up with an analogy. And to me, it was like putting down Old Yeller when Old Yeller only had like a case of poison ivy. And so
I thought you were going to go so much deeper than that, man.
Well, you know, come on. I'm not that smart.
Not Old Yeller. As we are live on the radio and on Ticket TV, we're now joined by our guy Sam Webb as the MGoBlog Roundtable is just underway. And Craig was making an analogy between Don Brown and Old Yeller. So that's a unique way to start here.
But don't you feel a certain sort of sadness about this? Isn't there something kind of unhappy about Don Brown not being a part of the program anymore, regardless of, you know, wins, losses? I mean, there's just something about his personality that felt like, yeah, this guy is kind of wacky and right enough to be a part of this. And so, and the Old Yeller part, I mean, is that I don't even know if he was a part of the sickness. It's not, I mean, Old Yeller was rabid, I guess. I don't, you know, it isn't even clear to me that he was at the core of Michigan's problems. And so I have a certain sadness about this, but maybe I'm just wrong. I don't know what you guys think or feel about that.
I think the basketball team won by 25 last night.
And was up by 37 at one point before they pulled the plug.
I mean, you're not wrong. It sucks that Don Brown, who gave very engaging press conferences and seemed like a really good dude, didn't work out here. And the reason he didn't work out is because Ohio State just had his number.
Yeah.
And then this year they just don't recruit to what they need to do. And I do feel like he bears a lot of responsibility for that. And that's not really, there's no way around the fact that if you're bringing Jim Harbaugh back, which is still in question.
Right.
Either way, you have to make some sort of this is going to be different move. And the fact that Don Brown is the obvious guy to move the needle is kind of where the program's at right now.
Yeah, I think that in watching so far, watching some of the names that have come up, the theme that is clear to me is Harbaugh wants some more variance in his zone. I mean, he wants to vary their zone coverages more than Don Brown ever was willing to. I mean, when people say play more zone, Don Brown played more zone.
Yeah.
I played a lot, but that meant he was going to do some form of cover two, oftentimes with some man elements to it. He is looking for a quarters guy. I am virtually certain of that. That is an aspect of whoever Jim Harbaugh's defensive coordinator is going to be. That is going to be in his zone bag. So that was, I'm sure you guys have been in a Don Brown press conference. He'd be ready to punch you if you ever mentioned quarters to him.
Yeah.
It was like no freaking way. He looked, that was like surrender to him. So I suppose you could play like that if you have pros everywhere. But man, if you don't, gonna be a problem.
Well, yeah. I mean, just saying that, you know, Brian's right. I mean, Ohio State has sort of killed him, but Ohio State is sort of killing everybody, it looks like. Sure. I mean, it isn't. And, you know, I don't know if you're playing quarters that you're going to do any better right now with the talent you have against Ohio State than if you're running a pedal to the metal. Maybe you'll lose by, 38, giving up 38 points versus giving up 55 points. I don't know. But I'm not sure that's really the solution here. I mean, I think there's no solution, though.
I don't think that's – look, I'm not saying that that's the mm-hmm. only piece. I think that's an element. I think recruiting is an element.
Yes.
As well, a big element. As you've seen the recruiting over the last few cycles, I mean, Michigan essentially, their secondary recruiting footprint is basically the East. And can that be the case if you're gonna narrow this gap any? That wound up being the case with, and not just because of Don Brown, but that's how your staff was composed. And he was definitely a big part of that emphasis in that region. So I see that being something that's addressed also.
But wasn't that sort of logical given the sort of football realities of the day? Programs don't consider a player from Massachusetts or Rhode Island or, a real player. They don't. They're second tier. Unless you're Boston College, you're not paying attention. And that gave Michigan some edge and some advantage. I think Quiddy Pay is actually a pretty good player, but no one was really paying much attention to him. I think he's from Rhode Island or something. Mo Hurst was actually a pretty good player from Boston, but he wasn't someone that they were paying attention to. And my theme has been, it hasn't been the coaching staff so much, except in one sense. I don't think we've evaluated talent particularly well. Maybe in New England we have, but we haven't evaluated it well enough 300 miles from Ann Arbor. And because I think you can win without five stars, without four stars, if you're really great at evaluating.
There's a huge difference here. I'm sorry, Brian. I want to get this out. There's a massive difference between, getting your butt kicked by Ohio State, which is, mm-hmm. And Ricky White taking the top off of your defense every single time. Like that. Fair that's point. The level Michigan was at this year. That's the reason mm-hmm. Don Brown was fired. I don't think that if Michigan is killing everybody and goes into the Ohio State game and gets eviscerated because Justin Fields look awesome and nobody can contain Chris Olave, that happens to everybody. That just happened to Clemson. And like, we bring up this quarters thing, like that's the answer. Jim, that's not the answer. Quarters is not going to be quarters is not a soft defense. Cover four is a soft defense, but you're not going to play cover four every down. Quarters is a hard defense. Quarters is setting the edges and bringing them down. And the reason D'Antonio fell apart in the end is he couldn't get safeties anymore who could play that one-on-one. Now, if we have those guys, if we have a Dax Hill every single time, go ahead and do it. If we have cornerbacks like, Trey Waynes, you can play that really hard.
January 7th, and I am done talking about football.
It's a piece. I think it's a piece of the equation. I don't think that you can make it one thing. But I do think that having that as a part of the arsenal, and it clearly was not with Don Brown. That's why I say when I say he's looking for a quarters guy, I don't say that to mean that that's all he's looking for. But it's definitely an element of whoever this guy is going to be. I think that's going to be in the toolkit, along with some other things like, and it's not going to just be a defensive coordinator thing when it comes to recruiting. I mean, that gap is not going to, it's not going to narrow by any back down from Ohio State. They aren't going. This might be the best era of recruiting in the history of that program. I've never seen a recruit better than this.
Yeah, you can't scheme your way out of that. There's no scheme that's going to beat an NFL offense, which is exactly what Ohio State is right now.
So, anyway, as far as what's going on, look, all I can tell you is I'm looking at these messages that are coming through. via the streams. All I can tell you is the expectation still is that he's going to sign it this week. Now, if he doesn't sign it this week, then I think that you start to have the posture for Michigan change and change noticeably when it comes to them, you know, weighing their options and possibilities. But checking again last night, folks don't think it's going to get to that. People still around here think he's going to sign it this week. So we'll see.
It's no different than I thought it was going to be from the very beginning. Michigan's going to offer a contract that's long-term, that has a low buyout. Harbaugh's going to look at that and say that's not a whole lot of security. He's going to shop the NFL, which, you know, just opened up, and they need a couple days to figure out what they want. And then we'll see. I think it just comes down to whether the NFL wants to sign him and wants to pay the kind of money that he wants. If they're not going to match it, then they'll sign with Michigan, and then we'll pretend this whole thing was just a, oh, turn down the NFL again. Harbaugh's here for life, right?
No, I don't think it's I don't think it's going to be one of those deals where I think you can see it in the fan reaction that there's very clearly a line that they're below, and I think the contract is going to be reflective of that. I think the buyout is going to be reflective of that. And if there was a haggling point, and I'm not in the room to know, but if there was one, I think it was the buyout. But at this point, I think that the numbers are the numbers, and it's your financial people or your financial team is looking over that. I don't know that there's much wiggle room at this point now.
Yeah, it's a job search, and these guys are businessmen. Everyone here is in business. So the NFL is in their business, Harbaugh's in his business, the program's in their business, and everyone's just figuring out the numbers right now. And I think that we're sitting here saying, what's going on? How come they can't decide this? Like, because they're having a contract negotiation. That's how these things work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it'll be. So tell me this. I didn't ask you guys this question. Let's assume that he's back. What defensive coordinators do you like? Are there any names that were intriguing to you?
Well, I mean, the names that are out there aren't really, and I guess Phil Parker is at least interesting. I've heard that name out there.
Guys, he's not gonna.
But I don't see that.
Yeah.
You know, I made my pick a couple weeks ago, and everyone went nuts with it. And so I'm.
Who was that?
Hankwitz. Mike Hankwitz. He's retired for now. Played for Bo. He's a Michigan grad. He's my age. You know, maybe he would come. And he's perfect because you don't have to hire him for 10 years or 5 years or 3 years. You hire him until the program begins to stabilize. And he grooms a new guy. But no one can say that guy hasn't been as good as anybody in the country over his career. He was 58-11 at Colorado. You know, so to me, he's the perfect choice. Because he's the grease in the system. And
Deerdorf and Brandstatter are going to be insufferable if that happens. Yeah. Those guys played next to him.
Okay. So anyway, but I'm not saying he would take the job, but I'm saying to me, given the situation in the program and this sort of basic uncertainty, he seems like, you know, it was like what the athletic department blew when they had the opportunity to rehire John Orr. I think I mentioned this once or twice, that after Fisher was canned, John Orr had just retired from Iowa State. And he came to the athletic department and said, I'll take the job for 1 year for free. You don't even have to pay me. I would let and I'll help you find a guy for next year. We can get a good young coach, and and we can get him in here and have a stress free system. Athletic department blew Orr off, and what I felt was a godfather offer, and so Hankwitz is, to me, is kind of the same idea, and I'll bet he could be talked into it.
Who's your guy, Seth?
A guy. John Heacock, Iowa State's defensive coordinator. I love that he's people kind of think just associate him with the weird defense they play, that Aztec defense with three high, where like their middle linebacker is literally hanging out with the safeties and then comes down, which is a cool defense. That's not the only thing he's run. And I looked back into some of the defenses he ran in Toledo, and this guy just, he changes his defense up based off of what his personnel are. I think that he's, you know, Iowa State, you can get that guy. And then if Michigan needs to move on from Harbaugh, you know, you already have Heacock here, and he's worked with the most obvious dude you move on to. So, you know, I think that Matt Campbell is Michigan's number one and probably only move if they do lose Harbaugh at this point. And if they don't, grab Heacock, and you already got a piece of that.
Brian, you have a guy that you like?
No.
No guy.
It doesn't matter.
What do you guys
think? Harbaugh is the coach here. It doesn't matter. He's not organized enough to consistently beat Ohio State. It does not matter.
What about?
Already Kirby? Did this with Gattis. It didn't work.
What about?
Already did it with Don Brown. It didn't work.
What if you?
Nothing's going to work.
What if you get?
There's no point. What?
Even with Chris Ash, even if you get Ohio State guy.
Chris Ash.
I'm asking.
Are you serious?
Yeah, what would you think of that?
It's. I mean, that's one of the worst names I've heard. You saw what he did at Rutgers, and you're like, okay, that guy. We need to import that. That's the kind of culture we need in our program.
And you saw how well Michigan recruited New Jersey when he was at Rutgers, by the way.
Well, he was at Rutgers at the end of the day.
Yeah, but Shiano's doing better than he was doing. And like, there's a lot of people at Rutgers who can recruit New Jersey better than him.
This is a fancy deck chair on the Titanic. There's no point even talking about it.
I like Derek Mason. I think he's going to go to.
Okay, that's going to work, yeah.
I think
it's not gonna work.
They're gonna hire someone.
They just put up 49 points on Brett Venables.
Yeah, they're gonna hire someone.
And Michigan is still gonna be starting a corner next year who is the number 17 player in the state of Michigan who they flipped away from Missouri at the last second. Yeah, that's so not gonna change.
So was he hired at Auburn? Was he already hired? Was Derek Mason already hired?
I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know.
I know he was on the list. Anyway, look, are you even gonna watch next year, Brian?
I have to. If I didn't have to, I would not.
There you go. All right. Well,
Jim Harbaugh is not going to turn this around. It's just not going to happen. So what are we talking about here?
We'll see. We'll see how it goes. We got to get to a break. We'll be back on the other side here, and we will shift gears and get into some basketball discussion. Second half of the hockey season as well. About to get underway, so much more to come here on the Michigan Insider on Sports Talk 1050 WTK, the ticket.
So,
clear on the video.
So, are we going to play other sports this winter? I mean,
women's gymnastics announced their schedule. Bev rejoins our show.
Okay, so that's good.
They'll slowly come out as they start announcing which sports are coming back and when.
Yeah, I think I saw something about wrestling and that because I noticed on the crawler that somehow Michigan is number two in the country in wrestling. And I know they've got phenomenal tennis teams right now, but I don't know if and when they're going to play.
Tennis seems like the easiest one because you're like that's like an inherently social distanced sport.
Yeah, tennis.
That'd be easy.
You'd think it would play, but you can't. I mean, we're members over at Varsity. And right now they're telling us singles is okay, but doubles, if you're playing doubles, you have to wear a mask. Well, who wants to play tennis wearing a mask? I don't know. I guess
wearing a mask where BU's making every opponent wear a mask to play basketball.
Oh, is that right?
Everybody that plays Boston University has to wear a mask. Craig, wrestling starts on Friday at Rutgers.
Rutgers has a good wrestling team too. They're a top 15 team on program. Yep.
And then Sunday at Maryland, and then they are home the following Sunday. The first home meet is January 17th. Yeah, because they did some cutouts. I saw that too. They did. Yeah. You can buy a cardboard cutout for Keene.
Brian can't watch football. I can't watch wrestling, only because it makes me squirm. When I'm wrestling, I'm watching wrestling. I'm squirming all the time, trying to get out of holds. It's really weird.
Yeah, and to Scott on the baseball, softball, they are not playing any non-conference games. They won't start till March.
Baseball doesn't start till March.
I believe they said that they're not, the Big Ten said they're not going to do any non-conference, so they're not going to play until March.
This would be a good opportunity for the Big Ten to break away. If they're not going to play any non-conference games at all, break away or like schedule some games in the summer against MAC teams or something. Like,
absolutely,
why not?
Well, I mean, they should play all summer. They should play at night. They should sell beer.
Piloted a attempt to get them to push the schedule back, and he had like buy-in from a bunch of the SEC coaches too.
Oh wow!
So I don't know when that might actually happen, but it does seem like there is a movement in the sport to play more over the summer.
Softball already draws even in cold days sometimes, but baseball, if you ran baseball in the summertime, it would pay for itself. Get rid of the stupid bats, bring back wooden bats, play in the summer.
Well, if you're asking them to pay for itself, then the wooden bats.
Pardon me?
Wooden bats would be counterproductive if you're asking it to the.
No, it would be a big help because the pro teams would love that because what
they already changed the bats to be a lot more like wood.
Oh, okay.
Back on radio in about 20 seconds, guys.
Okay.
And Mike, the non-conference for basketball, non-conference is full. The Penn State game is technically postponed, not canceled. That was from Mike on the comments here.
Yeah, Penn State,
technically it's postponed, and you can't add any. They played their 5 non-conference games already.
Yeah.
Stand by, guys. Coming back on radio. All right, back on radio in 5, 4, 3.
And we are back, folks, here on the Michigan Insider Sports Talk 1050 WTKA online at WTKA.com. Switching gears over to a basketball team that pushed its record to 10-0 last night with a 25-point victory over the Minnesota Golden Gophers, a team that had just beaten Ohio State, a team that had blown out Michigan State, a ranked team with a guy who's pushing for all Big Ten and Marcus Carr, one of the revelations in the Big Ten, and Liam Robbins. And they got absolutely owned last night. And it's the second game in a row where Michigan did that to a ranked opponent, which begs the question from me to you guys, after seeing this team go to 10-0, seeing Hunter Dickinson look like one of the best big men, not just the best freshman in the country, what's the ceiling for this Michigan team, you think, starting with you, Brian?
Final Four. I think that's well within reach. They're number 6 on KenPom right now. Like, Baylor and Gonzaga have clearly kind of separated themselves as the top two teams in the country. And you just watch those teams play and you're like, yeah. But anybody else, I think Michigan is in a game with, and given the way they're playing, I would take Michigan over the field outside of those two teams.
Seth?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Like, Iowa and Wisconsin are two of the teams ranked above Michigan. And, I mean, you're going to see how those go. But, like, Minnesota beat one of those teams. I mean, they got killed by Wisconsin. But, I mean, this is a good Minnesota team. They just did that, too. And there was, like, no hope. As soon as you want to adjust in the second half to whatever you're doing, or I guess the game previous to that, he adjusted in 3 minutes. And that's the thing, man. Michigan is not just firing on all cylinders, but not just the players, but like the coaching on this team. Who could imagine? I don't want to like do the comparison from Juwan to Beeline right now, but who could imagine we'd even like not feel in year two that like, oh my God, if we only had Beeline with this team?
Yeah, I mean that's. I don't know if that surprises me or not, but it sure has been a seemingly a well-coached team both last year and this year. There's no questions about that. It's really been an interesting year for me, and I've watched more Big Ten basketball, I think, than I ever have before. I've seen every team a lot, and there's no doubt in my mind that and the first, say, 10 or 11 teams in the conference, they can all beat each other. I mean, Michigan right now looks like the best team in the conference, but I also watched a really raggedy Rutgers and Michigan State game last night that looked almost nothing like basketball. And I came away thinking, you know, we're giving up on Michigan State a little, or, you know, maybe we're being hopeful and giving up on Michigan State a little too quick. As even though they really don't have a point guard, they're trying to put their freshman in there, Hogard, and that has improved that team. And they don't have a center, but they're still really athletic. And against Rutgers, where the refs just decided they're letting the game go, and it became a, you know, sort of a, I don't know what you call it, a wrestling match. They were real good at it. And but as far as Michigan goes, they played beautiful basketball, elegant basketball. I don't think people are talking enough about Franz Wagner. I think about 10 days ago on his presser, someone asked Phil Martelli about, well, doesn't this team really need a star or something like that? And he goes, yeah. And then the question was, who is that? And he goes, needs to be Franz. And I think he's right. And if you look at what Franz has done in the Big Ten, it is spectacular. His numbers across the board are them down here someplace. He's got like 14 points, seven rebounds. He's got two blocks a game. He's got a steal a game. His assists are 18 and four turnovers in five games, which is all, you know, 3.5 assists to almost no turnovers. He's taken, by my count, at most one bad shot or one sketchy shot a game at most. I mean, he is really playing incredible basketball. Right now. And when you match him with a really unselfish team, one that has some ability to shoot, and Hunter Dickinson, of course, who's just remarkable. I mean, his ball going up is so soft, it's impossible.
Better than John Teske there, correct?
Not on defense. Not on defense.
Well, wait a minute, because his defense yesterday, we have a guy, and the Matt from Endless Motor, who's in our Slack chat too, and yeah. he starts breaking these things down on Twitter all the time. Definitely follow him, Endless Motor. But yeah, he was breaking down things in the previous game about you know, how Hunter Dickinson moves his feet, and then John Beilein was talking about that too. How if I think on Brian's latest post, there's a link and you can watch what John Beilein thinks about Dickinson and how he moves his feet. Well, if you watch that same move when Liam Robbins tries it on Dickinson, he can't get his ankle around. He cannot get his feet positioned. And Liam Robbins has like been killing bigs all year. Now I know like the Big Ten has the top tier. Like, yeah. Yeah. So like those Ohio State guys are a little different, but like it was eye opening to see Liam Robbins shut down trying things that he likes to try, like trying post moves. And that's that Teske was good at that too. But Teske had some failings getting out to the perimeter as well. And I think that you can at least match Teske with Dickinson as a freshman. It's incredible.
I don't really agree with that. I mean, Teske was extremely good at hedging. And that's something we saw from Dickinson for the first time in his career. And I think the first time with any consistency since Juwan Howard's been here is, you know, you have those two threes for Marcus Carr at the end of the first half, and they go in the locker room and they come out and they start hedging, sometimes flat, sometimes a straight up blitz on Marcus Carr. It's not every time out, but it's enough that Carr doesn't know that he's going to be able to come off that screen and just rise up, because that's what he does. He's only half of his threes are assisted and he's shooting like 40%. So he's a guy who you absolutely have to check on those. So we saw Dickinson hedge and recover, which is not something that that Juwan Howard seemingly wants to do very much. But Dickinson's agility in doing that was excellent. There was one where he pushed Carr almost out to the logo without even coming close to a foul. So I think that was a lot of progress. And that was the first real big man that Dickinson has played this year, and he put up 28 on 12 of 15 shooting.
Yeah, it makes me think about Hunter's evolution, because I agree with you, Brian. I think that John Teske was I thought his ball screen coverage was part of what defined him as a player at Michigan. Hunter Dickinson to talk about his footwork and how well he moves is like, you wouldn't have been having that conversation a year and a half, 2 years ago, but he has gotten in better shape. I know it was the emphasis of his as a senior to be able to be in better shape. And that was mostly about defense. And I remember him talking about that. Like, I got to be able to move better. He's never going to be a run jump guy, but can he cover more ground? Can he, you know, can he come from the weak side and be a shot blocker, more of a presence on the defensive end of the floor? And then you add in John Sanderson and what he's done to get him in even better shape. Now you get into a game where he played, what, 32 minutes last night? And you got him hard hedging ball screens. You aren't even preserving him on that end of the floor. I mean, that's one of the, I think, one of the benefits of, you know, a little bit of drop coverage in there. You aren't taxing your bigs quite as much. But he was doing a fantastic job last night on both ends of the floor. I think that's a testament to him, to Juwan, and definitely to John Sanderson for getting him to this point. It was the biggest test that he's faced to date, and he absolutely obliterated Leon Robbins last night. I he had to be thinking at some point, Craig, this is the guy that this is the guy that everyone was talking about. He destroyed him.
Well, you're right, and Brian's right, of course, that it was interesting in the second half how they changed their ball screen defense up, and it really worked. And Carr seemed completely, I wouldn't say lost, but very frustrated by what they did in the second half in particular. And Robbins, who played, you know, is coming off a great game, 24 points and 14 rebounds, something like that. I think he might have been Big Ten Player of the Week, but it was against Ohio State. And as Brian points out, well, Ohio State doesn't really have a center. But early in this game, I think Robbins, didn't he score the first 5 points? He made a nice little left-handed hook, and then he stepped out. He hit a three in the first couple of minutes of the game, and after that, he was a complete cipher. I don't think he made another shot in the game. I'm pretty sure he didn't score another point in the game.
He did not.
And so Dickinson handled him well, and the team defense was good. Everyone is buying in. You know, I was worried about Mike Smith, thinking, you know, I'm not sure this guy can really, you know, play defense at a Big Ten level. But what Mike Smith is doing really well is fighting over the top of screens. And I always, when I was, you know, even in pickup ball, I hated fighting over the top of screens. I just hated that. And because it's just such hard work. And he's doing it. And doing it very well. Last night, if you watch Mike Smith fighting over the screens, it was remarkable. Of course, the coaching staff says Eli's their best defender, and I think that's probably a reasonable assessment. And he's playing terrific on defense. I love Shondy's defense. So this is a team that I think Juwan said it in his press conference after the game last night, where they looked at where could we improve, and he decided the biggest place where they could improve is on defense, which is kind of interesting because they lost X and Teske, you know, probably, you know, their two best defenders, but this is a better defensive team than it was last year, right now, at least. I think KenPom, at least, I don't know what has them, but KenPom has them up in the, I think like number 15 or something on defense, and they're 6 on offense. So it's been a very highly successful season. I think the sky is the limit. I agree with you guys. You know, Gonzaga is probably better, but last time I checked, we actually beat Gonzaga last year and actually kicked the crap out of them. It wasn't even a close game. And so anything is possible. But I think we're going to see some losses too. Big Ten is too good.
Right.
It's not like this is just going to keep rolling this way. Every team in this conference can play. There's going to be some bumps in this road, but the ceiling is high, that's for sure.
Oh, I thought you were going to go in there, Brian. Yeah, I feel like you mentioned Mike Smith. I feel like his command, his sort of feel for the rest of the team, and on top of the scheme is really there. I love the two-man game chemistry with Hunter last night. It just felt like that their connection in ball screen situations was the best it's been so far. That's how it felt, at least watching it live. And it was noteworthy to me that when Mike Smith went out toward the end of the first half was when Minnesota went on their little run there.
Yeah.
You know, you can really feel the difference when Mike Smith is out there running the team and when he's on the bench. And that says something about him as a point guard.
Yeah. And he was getting blow bys against MAC teams earlier in the year, right? And like, I can't remember the last time when Michigan had a defensive possession and I was like, Mike Smith kind of got worked on that one. He got singled up on Marcus Carr on a switch late last night. And Marcus Carr got forced into, he was either a really tough two or he just had to get rid of the ball. And like, he's small, so he's never going to be a guy you can't shoot over. But he was really doing a great job of crowding Kalsher last night. And like, he's been up on three-point shooters and fighting over screens, as Craig mentioned. And just kind of a sea change from earlier in the year where we're like, is this guy going to be kind of the Achilles heel of the defense? And you know, he's not Eli and he's not Franz Wagner. He's not going to fill up a box score on defense, but he's really rounded into a guy who doesn't really seem like a weak point you can go after. And to do that in, you know, 6, 8, 10 games as a redshirt senior grad transfer is really impressive. And I think it shows that how much he wants to win. And that's the same thing with Shondi, right? So Shondi is trying for the Tayshaun Prince block in a 35-point game. Like, and he's just going 1,000 miles an hour all the time because he was on a terrible he won 14 ACC games in 3 years, and he's in a position now where it doesn't matter what the score is, how much Michigan is up, he is desperate to win. And I think those two transfers have really brought that to Michigan in a way that this is a great culture. Everybody on this team, it has been part of Beeline or Howard. They know what they're doing, but they don't know what it's like to be on a 1-13 Ivy team. And Mike Smith does.
Yeah. Yeah. That's just such a good point, Brian. I mean, you're bringing in two guys who are good basketball players, but have always played on bad teams. And I saw, in fact, last year, Columbia played Wake and that game came away. Columbia blew a 5-point lead in the last minute or two, largely because of terrible officiating. The game was at Wake, of course. But the Mike Smith, I think, said maybe after the second game of the season, someone asked him, you know, was he excited to be 2-0 or something like that? And he goes, yeah, I don't ever remember being 1-0. So it was sort of a really endearing and amusing comment, I thought. And yeah, so 10-0 for Sean D and Mike Smith, yeah, they're bought in because those kids are playing on a team that's a really good team and they know it. And the other thing is that appeals to me about both of them, particularly Sean D, is they play with such joy. I mean, whole team, right, plays with joy. And that's, you know, that's really a nice thing. There's nothing grim.
Yeah, they have the bench with joy. I mean, I don't know that they've had a bench guy like Jace Howard before.
That may be right.
Level. That's Andrew Dockich erasure, but Arnoldstein too. Come on, man.
I
knew the tray three was going in before it went in.
He did do that. But I think Jace takes it to another level for sure. But you see that attitude sort of permeating the team and asking the guys about it. I think it has to do with how connected they are. And maybe it's just similar to those other teams. But I think what makes this unique is that those other teams that we're talking about have been together for a long time.
Yeah.
This is, you know, this is a lot of new coming together, and you can really, really see the chemistry already. And I guess, you know, one good point on this came from Isaiah Livers. He said, you know, the chemistry, the cohesion as far as the personalities and getting to know one another was enhanced by an unfortunate circumstance. We can't see anybody else. We don't spend time anywhere other than the basketball building and at home. We're always together. So we have gotten to know and to like each other a lot quicker than you generally would see with a lot of new guys on the team.
I think that's what's happening at Michigan State, that Tom Izzo is 10% of people that they're actually interacting with.
A lot to take. A lot to take. All right. All right, so you guys asked the or answered the ceiling question for Michigan. So would that mean, or does that mean that in your Big Ten power rank, just of the top four, that you would have Michigan at the top of your list? I'll give you Tim McCormick's, which I actually co-signed right now. He had Illinois number one. He had Wisconsin number two, which is my preseason number one. Michigan number three, Iowa number four. How would you guys do that real quick so we can get some hockey in?
Well, I mean, Michigan did not lose to Maryland like Wisconsin did. And Illinois has been kind of up. I don't know. I mean, it's real close between the two of them. I mean, Illinois has done more, I guess, but it's very close.
Yeah, I think it's very close and hard to distinguish. I think we'll have a better sense after Tuesday. Wisconsin, incidentally, and I heard this, I think, with your podcast with Tim, is, I mean, these guys are middle-aged. I mean, I didn't realize that Dimitri Trice is going to be 25 next month.
You could start for them.
Yeah. And I could start for the nursing home team, but Aline Ford is 25. They got two 25-year-olds this year. And then the other guys are like 23. So,
and they all have eligibility next year, too.
And they all have eligibility next year. Probably none of them is going to the NBA anyway. So you got, I mean, this team is so old. And you know, old, but old. And to some extent, this is like what's going on with hockey. And it'd be good if Brian speaks to that. I mean, Michigan has a team that's really talented, but they're very young. And they're playing, because of the nature of hockey, against a bunch of guys in their mid-20s often. And so it'll be interesting to see how on Tuesday Michigan does with a really, really old, experienced, smart, well-coached team. And
I think it's a good thing that the Penn State game got canceled.
I think you're right.
Like, that turnaround really scared me, and I was just going to chalk up the Wisconsin game as like, okay, turning around from a Sunday game with Penn State, because Penn State's going to work you. Now they can really focus on these guys, but like, they did such a great job against Northwestern, which is a similar 5-out team, but like, their answer for Northwestern was to let Barron just go off, right, and let that guy shoot, because that guy has no usage. Well, that guy is Nate Reuvers for Wisconsin, and you can't do that with them. So they're going to have something, and I'm really interested to see what Howard's going to have prepared for that.
Switching gears real quick to get some hockey in, guys, basically the second half here. They started out like gangbusters. I talked to Mel about this morning. 4-0, we're talking about a different freshman every single game. Then they lose five of the next six. Granted, they had some guys leave for World Juniors, but a heavily penalized team. You know, they couldn't score in a few games. That is probably not going to be a problem for this team. But I wonder what you think about how heavily penalized they've been, where they are defensively. Brian, starting with you, what do you see is the second half outlook for the Michigan hockey team?
Well, over the course of the past decade, if you have a guy like Max Pacioretty on your team, if you have a guy like a TJ Hensick, just those really highly touted freshmen, often what happens is the first half of the year, you're kind of like waiting for it to come. And you're like, well, what's going on with this guy? He's supposed to be like everything. And then you see it click for them in the second half. So I think, you know, Maddie Beniers is coming back from the World Juniors as one of the most touted guys on that gold medal winning team. I think he's a candidate for a major breakout. Kent Johnson, you know, the penalties thing is just a little bit odd because they've been dominating attack time in some of these games, dominating zone time. And you look at the penalties in the game and it's 6-1 for the other team. And part of that's inexperience. And part of it is just like, I don't want to go Craig Ross on this, but
that's okay. Because I think Mel went all Craig Ross today.
Don't be mad at him because he's so good and he's so young. But I think that'll tend to even out. And I kind of feel like referees aren't putting Michigan on the power play because they've seen Michigan's power play, which is lethal. And if they can just get to it sufficiently often, I think they're going to have a good second half of the season. So, you know, it's been a little confounding because they start off and Arizona State appears to be actually a pretty solid team and they just decimate them. And then, you know, they get swept by Notre Dame, but you watch those games and they're just Notre Dame games where, you know, the first team who scores gets to win and the goals that Notre Dame scores are just like complete flukes. And then, you know, Minnesota, you got half your team gone, that kind of thing. So,
and Minnesota might be as good as any team in the country.
Yeah, and Minnesota is like a team that has a ton of talent like Michigan and is older too.
Yeah, they're Michigan next year.
Yeah, so I wasn't totally surprised that Michigan kind of couldn't hang with Minnesota, but you know, I think they'll accelerate coming down the stretch here.
Yeah, the thing with Minnesota is, like, you know, Michigan felt like they were missing their Team USA guys. Minnesota lost two top defensemen and replaced them with two top defensemen and just kept on rolling. And, I think when Michigan gets their guys back, like, huh?
Michigan goes down three centers as well as two defensemen. So, like,
right.
Minnesota was able to plug and play with their defensemen somewhat, and then Michigan was just... You're messing up all your lines. It was a difficult ask against a very good team,
right? And that team went and won the gold. So they're those guys will make a difference. Plus, like they've got. I mean, Minnesota is a hard team. Penn State's just a weird team. Like you know, that 9-goal game is a fluke, right? Like that's just a weird thing that happens against Penn State once in a while. And you know, they got Michigan State coming next, and that's. But you know, those are probably two wins, and you get all your guys back for Ohio State, and I think that the second half's going to be pretty good.
Frozen Four?
Yeah, I mean, I would certainly predict – I'm sorry, what did you say, Sam?
Frozen Four? Are we going to be talking Final Four and Frozen Four?
I mean, no. Just because the hockey tournament is so random, you just can't predict – that this team is going to be in the Frozen Four until you see a little bit more from them.
I'm going to predict they're going to make the Frozen Four. I think it will turn around. I think there's enough talent there. I can't see that they're going to continue to get, you know, one power play every other game or whatever it's been. I don't think that's going to continue to happen. I'm looking for, I mean, and I think Mel showed some optimism in your interview this morning, Sam, also, and I'm going to feed off that and think they have a really good chance of making the Frozen Four.
Well, yeah, he said something a couple of weeks ago you know, before we went into the holiday break where he said, all my teams are second half teams. We hit it, we get it going in the second half. He sort of explained why. I mean, it happens too consistently for it to just be this thing that just happens. He's, you know, they spend the first half of the season playing everyone and figuring out who can do what and how they fit together. And then they sort of concentrate things in the second half with that knowledge they gained from the first half of the season. They're really able to hit their stride. So he fully expects scoring to not be a problem. He really called out though, focus, effort, and intensity defensively. He said, you know, we got to be grittier on that end. We got to be more hard nosed on that end and not just be like, hey, we got the best goalie in the country behind us. He said, you can't lean on that. He said, you know, we clean that up, which we will. He said, this will be a second half team, too. It's hard not to buy into his optimism when he's had, you know, the kind of success that he's had.
Gritty is fine, but I watched the Minnesota series and they were just outpowered. You know, especially the young guys, they're just not strong enough quite yet. And that was a strategy for any team is trying to get Michigan to dump it. And I think it's even more so with the forwards that, like, you cannot play dump and chase with this team right now.
Yeah, he you know what? The way he put it, it's a thing for him because he said, we try to be too pretty, I think is what he said. He says, you know, we try to score the pretty goals. He was talking about that when he was talking about, you know, some of the scoring issues they had at times. But on defense, when it came to talking about defense, he said, hey, man, same kind of deal. Maybe it's they aren't as capable of imposing their will physically, but he doesn't want the size to limit the amount of fighting the dog.
And that's how you got to coach the team. But you know, they're a pretty team.
So basically, they can only be so gritty, is what you think.
Right, right. And I love that they're pretty. You know, I'm a 90s Red Wings fan. I love pretty teams.
I hear you. Well, fellas, hopefully next week when we come back for the roundtable, we'll be talking about, some resolution. Because I'm still seeing questions on the timeline. Hey, what's going on with this Harbaugh thing? Hopefully that there will be an end to this next week. We will have some resolution. And we will be talking about something else to start. Maybe he'll have some hires done by that point, too. So, guys, I hope you had a fun holiday. Had a lot of family time with the family. I had a lot of time with the family, I should say. And glad to have you back with this family. I guess the next thing would be, since no Penn State game, the Michigan-Wisconsin game. Who wins that one? Who will we be talking about when we come back next Thursday?
I got to give it to Michigan right now. I mean, they've not only beaten but dismantled two top 20 teams, and I have a lot of respect for Wisconsin and their AARP starting lineup, but I feel like given the mobility Dickinson showed, he might be able to pop out on those stretch bigs, and I don't know how well they're going to handle him in the post.
Yeah, I think I've seen some of those guys in my Thursday night game. So I'm going with Wisconsin this week. I think Michigan meets their Waterloo, but I think it's a temporary blip, and they may be better for it.
Yeah. Michigan's a young team, and you know they get a long time to prepare for this. But Wisconsin's it's just narratively it's got to happen. Like Brad Davison always just takes away anything that's good for Michigan, so he'll come to Ann Arbor and do it again.
All right, well, folks,
protect your privates.
I was more circumspect about that thing.
Live on air. Cups on a basketball court. Huh? We got to get out of here, folks. Thanks for listening to the Michigan Insider on Sports Talk 250 WTK, the ticket, the official voice of University of Michigan Sports, Ann Arbor, a Cumulus station.
Clear on the radio and by broadcast.